Yeah, welcome to today's webinar. The topic today is soil structure interaction in RFEM. My name is Andreas Hörold. I will be the presenter today. I'm responsible for marketing and public relations, for instance, the Dluba website, press releases, customer projects, and the German and English webinars. My colleagues Markus and Adrian will support me during this webinar. They will answer your questions, but they can introduce themselves.
Hello, my name is Markus Baumgärtel. I'm responsible for customer support and our database for frequently asked questions. Today I will answer your questions during the webinar.
Yeah, hi, my name is Adrian Langhammer. I'm responsible for product engineering, especially for the concrete design modules, but I'm also responsible for customer support, and today I will answer your questions in the chat.
Okay, thank you for your introduction. I think we can switch off the webcams that the attendees can see the whole screen. On the right side of your screen, you can open a control panel where you can ask questions via chat. Yeah, Adrian and Markus will answer you. If you don't get an answer during the webinar because there are too many, you will get an email after the webinar. The other way is to watch the entire webinar and then email your questions to info@global.com. To the agenda today, at first I present different soil models here in RFEM. Then I utilize the soil models in RFEM. I present the different soil models here in the PowerPoint, and then I utilize the soil models in RFEM. That's the right way. Okay, with this floor slab here, that's the example for all the soil models, and at the end I design the floor slab in RFEM. To the soil models, first the subgrade reaction modulus method, the modified subgrade reaction modulus method, the modified two-parametric soil model with foundation overlaps, the modified two-parametric soil model with additional springs, the stiffness modulus method, and the 3D half space analysis. Now, in the same order, I faded them in here. I will introduce now the single soil models. At first, the subgrade reaction modulus method. Now, the Winkler's foundation constant, or the modulus of subgrade reaction, depends on the load and is actually no soil property. The formula is Ks equals to soil contact stress divided by settlement. To the graphics here, on the right side, the deformation is only directly under the load by the subgrade reaction modulus method, because there is no shear resistance of the soil considered, and there is no subsidence basin outside the edges, like for the stiffness modulus method that you can see here on the bottom. This behavior would be if there is loose sand, and this is actually or usually not the case. To reduce these deficiencies of the subgrade reaction modulus method, there are different approaches. For example, according to Durkin and Dana, they suggest to increase the modulus at the edges. You can see here in the graphic, it's 2 times Ks, and here a linear increasement in that quarter. Another approach is according to Bellman and Katz. Way suggests to increase this upgrade reaction modulus by the factor of 4 at the edges here. Way suggests to use one finite element row. To the evaluation of the subgrade reaction modulus method, advantages are the easy input, the short computation time, because there's no iterative calculation, and it's possible to extend to the modified subgrade reaction modulus method. Disadvantages are the inadequate soil modeling. It's not possible to consider adjacent soil areas or soil's shear resistance. It's not possible to define soil layers or structures interaction. There are a few realistic results. My opinion is the subgrade reaction modulus method does no longer meet today's requirements, and it's contrary to increasingly precise structural analysis. The next soil model is the modified two-parametric soil model with foundation overlaps. Where is the foundation overlap here around the floor slab? And this foundation overlap has a very small stiffness. And it should be created so large that the settlement is close to zero. Best is to have got an soil expertise, but if there is no soil expertise with the modulus of subgrade reaction, etc. available, there are formulas according to Pasternak and Barbashov, where the modulus of subgrade reaction and the shear resistance can be calculated. Input data or necessary input data would be the modulus of elasticity or the shear, the stiffness modulus, the elastic foundation depth, and the Poisson's ratio. Then the next soil model is the modified two-parametric soil model with additional springs. Where the effective soil model method according to Kohler and Nemetz, there are line springs and single springs at the edges. It's possible, if not available, to calculate the shear resistance according this formula. But the disadvantage is, you have to estimate the range of subsident basin. You can see it. The distance from the slab edge where settlements drop under 1% of the foundation edge values. That's quite difficult, I think, to estimate that. But there are reference values for C2, means the shear resistance. They should be, or it should be between 0.1 times the modulus of subgrade reaction and 1 times the modulus of subgrade reaction. If there is loose sand, C2 is towards zero, and if there is solid rocks, C2 or the shear resistance is towards 1. And if there is an average shear capacity, the shear resistance is the half of the modulus of subgrade reaction. And then with this parameters, it's quite easy to calculate the line springs according this formula and the single springs at the outer edges. To the advantages and disadvantages of the two parametric soil models. Advantages are realistic results if used properly. It's possible to consider adjacent soil areas or shear, soil shear resistance. It has a short computation time because there is no iterative calculation. And the definition of structures interaction is possible when utilizing the soil model with foundation overlaps. Disadvantages are additional consideration and inputs necessary. As you remember, that's necessary to estimate the subsidence basin, for example. There's no definition of structures interaction possible when utilizing the soil model with additional springs, and the definition of soil layers only approximately. The next soil model is the stiffness modulus approach. It's not necessary to read the whole text here. You can read the whole presentation, or the slides are available on our website. I can show you at the end of the webinar how you can download the slides and models, etc. In short, the FE program creates a stiffness matrix in that area here between the structure and the soil, and in referent points where is then iterative calculation until the deformation of the slab and the deformation of the soil is the same. Iterative calculation. The advantages of the stiffness modulus approach are there are usually realistic results. A realistic soil modeling is possible. It's possible to consider adjacent soil areas, and the definition of layers and interaction between the structures is also possible. Disadvantages are only longer computation time because of the iterative calculation. It's a non-linear calculation, but I think with today's computers, it's not a big problem. The computation time is not a big problem. I can show you later in RFM. I believe that the stiffness modulus method is the technically perfect solution. The stiffness modulus method is utilized in RFM together with the RF Säulen module. You will see later in the example how to do that. The last soil model is the 3D half space analysis, where is the soil is created with FE or 3D FE elements here, and they should be modeled here until the sediment decreases. I will show you also this model or this soil model in RFM. Advantages are the very realistic soil modeling. It's possible to consider adjacent soil areas and the definition of soil layers and interaction between structures works very well. And it's also no iterative calculation. Disadvantages. It's a high generation process and increased effort when evaluating results. The software system must have 3D solid elements, and the biggest disadvantages is the high memory requirement and the long computation time. Okay, that's all to the introduction here. I turn to the program RFM. You can see here different soil models. The subgrade reaction modulus method on the left side, and here in the middle the two modified two parametric soil models, here with the foundation overlaps and here with the additional springs. You can see the line springs and the single springs, the outer edges, And here's the stiffness modulus method, yeah, using RFSoilin. I modeled the same floor slab here for all soil models. It has a thickness of 20 centimeters with that concrete. The same load cases. It's loads from a three-story building. Post load here, snow load, etc. Then the load combinations and the result combinations for ultimate limit state and serviceability limit state. Here the foundation overlap is only 0.1 millimeters thick. Yeah, it has a very small stiffness, but the same surface support as the foundation, the floor slab. How I calculated these values here, I will show you in the PowerPoint, also for the line springs and the single springs. Just a moment, I open the PowerPoint again. Here's the first example with the modified two-parametric soil model with foundation overlap. The input values are the modulus of elasticity, 10,000 kilonewton per square meter, the elastic foundation depth of 5 meters, and the Poisson's ratio 0.2. I use the same input values for all soil models in RFM. Then I calculated the soil parameters according to Barbashov. Here the modulus of subgrade reaction and the shear resistance. For the example with the modified two-parametric soil model with additional springs, I use the same modulus of subgrade reaction. And yeah, for the shear resistance, I assumed an average shear capacity, and that's the formula. The shear resistance is the half of the modulus of subgrade reaction. Then here the formulas for the line springs and the single springs at the outer edges. That's the single spring. Now we remember the 520 kilonewton per meter, and we are searching for that value here in RFM. That's the single spring, and here you can find the 520 kilonewton per meter. Okay, now that's all to these three soil models. Then we come to the stiffness modulus method. I open RFSoilin. So here you can see the general data I calculated with the Eurocode standard, and I used the load combination 16 with quasi permanent loads. Then here the soil parameters. Here is the modulus of elasticity, the same as for the other soil models, 10,000 kilonewton per square meter. The Poisson's ratio 0.2, and the depth of the soil of 5 meters. Then RFSoilin calculated the modulus of subgrade reaction, or the elastic foundation coefficients, automatically according to the loads. Can see here higher values at the edges and smaller values on the inside. And here the soil layers, it's only one soil layer in that example. Okay, and I compare the results for the load combination 16. I open the result diagram. So I switch off the PSET, but switch on the MY, basic internal forces. Yeah, as you can see here, the three soil models, the subgrade reaction modulus method, and the two modified two-parametric soil models here, there are the nearly the same deformations, means the settlement, and also the contact stresses are similar for all soil models. But the settlement for the stiffness modulus method is very small, there's a factor of approximately 3. Why is that like it is? The modulus of subgrade reaction is only by the stiffness modulus method calculated according to the loads. And for these soil models, for these three soil models, it's not depending from the load. I will increase the load and you will see that the factor is not three anymore, because the modulus of subgrade reaction doesn't change for that three soil models here, but for the stiffness modulus method. Okay, to the basic internal forces, that's completely wrong. That's the stiffness, the subgrade reaction modulus method. You can see only negative MY values. And here these three graphics are quite similar, especially the ones for the soil model with the additional springs and the stiffness modulus method. Okay, we take a last look at this factor here, 3. I will change the load now in the calculation parameters. Load combination 16. And I modify the loading by a factor 5 in this example. Okay. So now there's a new calculation for RF Soilin and the load combination 16. And you will see it takes not too long. Just a few seconds. Okay, so now we go back in the section, the result diagram. And now you can see the settlement or the different between the settlements. It's not like it was. We haven't got a factor 3 anymore, because there is a new calculation of the modulus of subgrade reaction for the stiffness modulus method and not for these three soil samples, soil models. Okay, we change it back because we want to continue with this model. Okay. But before I continue, I show you another model with the 3D half space analysis, where a solid with 3D FE elements. Clay descent. It's a linear model. I've got the same floor slab here with the same loads as for the other soil models. And if we take a look at the results for the load combination 16, I open the result diagram again. You can see the settlement, and the settlement decreases towards zero. And here, nearly the same MY graphic as for the stiffness modulus method and the model with the or method with the additional springs. But the disadvantage is, takes longer computation time. It took more than 1 minute for only the to calculate only the load combination 16 with my computer, and my computer has a memory of 20 gigabytes. Okay, then we turn back to the soil models. I continue only with the stiffness modulus method. And I would like to introduce some more features of half soiling. It's possible to define more soils. I open the database and choose here sand, gravelly sand for the first soil, then clay. Okay. And clayly sand. Where is it? Clayly sand. Here. Okay. The add-on module takes over the parameters here automatically. The modulus of elasticity, the Poisson's ratio, and the specific weight. I would like to consider three soil layers. The first place is the same as it was here. For the sand gravelly sand, I define 1 meter. Then for the clay, 3.5 meters, and the clayly sand, 3 meters. Okay, then another soil sample on the other edge. Not the same layers, but with different thicknesses. 2 meters for the sand, then half a meter for the clay, and 5 meters for the clayly sand. These soil sample has not has sand only sand with 1 meter and the clay 3.5 meters means that the load bearing capacity is worse, yeah, and for this soil sample it's better. I would like to show you the different modulus of subgrade reaction and the different settlements. It's also possible to consider groundwater, rock beneath the last layer, or additional geological regions. If you want to consider two or four number of soil layers in on different points, and then you need to check this and define other numbers of soil layers on this on that point. To the details, I leave all the settings here except the edge distance from the foundation surface. I define 5 meters here. Okay, and then we calculate all. Now it takes some seconds, but I think not too long. In these tables, where are the stresses and settlements, and the elastic foundation coefficients, but we take a look at the graphic. Here you can see the soil samples. All values between the soil samples are interpolated. And here you can see the better elastic foundation coefficients here on that edge, and lower values at this or in this area here. And if we take a look at the settlement or deformation in Z direction, you can see here a higher settlement where the load bearing capacity is worse. Okay, that should be all to the soil samples or soil models. And now I continue with the design of the floor slab in half concrete surfaces. I open it. Okay, the first dialogue with the general data, I design according to Eurocode and the National Annex of Germany. As you can see, there are a lot of annexes are available. For the ultimate limit state, I apply the ultimate limit state combinations. And for the serviceability limit state, I applied characteristic combinations and quasi permanent load combinations. Now we used the analytical check or design. I open here the details. I leave all parameters here as they are, except I design also the concrete stresses. Okay, next dialogue. I use the same material as in RFM. The surface number 4 is automatically detected. Here the stress check. I leave the parameters as they are, but it's also possible to define alpha multiplied by FC key manually, or the alpha multiplied by FY key manually. The limit of crack widths I define at, on the top, XC1, it's an internal component, and on the bottom XC2, because it's a foundation component. I uncheck this. We want to design with direct crack width calculation according to Eurocode. Then here on the right side, I would like to consider restraint. I choose here approach of pure tension restraint, because I assume I applied that because we want to consider concreting against rough soil. Now we consider also early age of concrete, a crack formation in the first 28 days, and we define here 0.65. Now simplified for thin components less or equal 30 centimeters. At the end of the webinar, I show you the knowledge base article where you can see why here 0.65 is defined. Then we consider external action due to restraint on the safe side. Next dialog, for the reinforcement ratios, I leave the parameters as they are. The reinforcement layout, I define here a cover for reinforcement according to the standard. On the bottom XC2, because it's a foundation component, and on the top XC1, because it's an internal component. That's all. Then the longitudinal reinforcement, I define here a basic reinforcement. I open here that library and choose mesh reinforcement of Q335A at the top and on the bottom. Okay. Then I define here the same diameter. It's better for the calculation to have the same diameters for the basic reinforcement and the additional reinforcement. Also, the cover should be the same. Okay, then to the standard parameters. I leave the parameters as they are, but it's possible to define other factors, for example, manually. Okay, to the design method, we apply the optimization of design internal forces because we have got bending in the floor slab. Then I calculate all. Here we've got the required reinforcement. Now we will see it better in the graphic, but here the table with the serviceability design, the design check for the concrete stress, the steel stress, the minimum reinforcement, and the crack widths. As you can see here, there are no cracks in the floor slabs. Okay, we take a look at the graphic. Yeah, you can see we've got the same values on the whole floor slab, different values for AS1 and AS2 on the bottom and at the top, because restraint is decisive. Yeah. If I check here only the ultimate limit state, you can see different values for AS1 top, AS2 top, on the bottom, and here also on the bottom. Okay, in that case, the serviceability limit state with the restraint is decisive, but that must don't have to be the case anytime. Okay, I use that graphic, and I would like to print all the four graphics in the printout report. I think it's good to see that if I have the same reinforcement on all places, I use that value, and it must be on the whole floor slab. Okay, then I print directly in the printout report a height of 50%, and I do a mass print. The results of concrete surfaces add-on module. Okay, and here I select all four graphics. Okay. I choose the input data and reduced results. Take some seconds. Okay, here we can see the graphics, all four graphics only with different values. Also, the off-soilent parameters are included here. The soil samples, the materials, stresses and settlements, etc. Now, it would be good to have a graphic here as well, maybe with the soil samples and the modulus of subgrade reaction. Yeah, how to do that? That have you seen as I printed the off concrete surfaces graphics? It's the same procedure. Okay. Yeah, that's the end of the presentation in RFM. I would like to turn back to the PowerPoint. Here's the bibliography. I would like to introduce some free online services that we provide. For example, the GeoZone tool with snow, wind, and seismic zone maps. 5 clicks per day are for free. Then the cross-section properties, also a free online tool where you can also define parameterized cross-section and calculate the cross-section properties for such cross-sections. Then the FAQs and knowledge base, where are a lot of valuable articles, all of them for free. Then the models to download, maybe to become familiar with the programs. Then our free YouTube channel with the recorded webinars and videos. The webshop is with prizes. Then the 90-day free trial version. The free trial version is contains all add-on modules, for example, also AvSoilen and AvConcrete Surfaces that I showed in this webinar. Then you can subscribe our newsletter that we can inform you about news in our software or webinars and other events. Okay, at the end, I would like to show you the website where you can find the models and the recording here under news and events, webinars. That's today's webinar. You will get an email the next days with a link to that page here. Here you will find the recording. Here you can download the slides that I showed in the webinar. And here the free RFM models. Okay, then we are on the end of the webinar. Maybe my colleagues can also switch on their webcams. Thank you for your attention. Thank you to Markus and Adrian for answering the questions. I hope it would be fine if we can meet each other in another webinar in the future. I wish you a nice rest of the day. And bye-bye.
Bye-bye. Also from my side.
Bye.